Yes, sir, we are live now.
Good evening, guys, and welcome to the last session of newborn examination. And today we'll be dealing with the neurological examination of newborn and a final note on the gestational age assessment. Okay, so guess we can start with the session. I'll just share my screen. So audio is fine and screen is visible, right? Both on YouTube and Zoom.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, fine. Okay, fine. Now coming to neurological system. So basically, we divide it under first one. We start with the higher mental function. Okay. So under higher mental function, what do we see? First is the consciousness. And in the beginning only, we saw that at what stage of consciousness we should examine the baby. And we go there. We had seen that either at stage three, mostly ideal will be stage three or stage four. Correct. And that time we had mentioned something called as Prechel score. Correct. So what the scoring system used for the consciousness is, there are two. One is Prechel scale, other one is Bresselton scale. So these are the two scale that is used for, to know the consciousness of the newborn, state of consciousness of the newborn. Now let's see the Prechel scale. Okay, let's see Prechel scale. In Prechel scale, what do we see? One is the eye opening of the newborn, other one is regular respiration of the newborn, gross movements and vocalization or cry. Okay, so these are the things we'll concentrate in the Prechel scale. In that comes stage 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Deep or quiet sleep, light or REM sleep, awake and drowsy, alert. Okay, fine. So stage 1 will not have eye opening. There will be regular respiration pattern and there won't be any gross movements and there won't be any vocalization or cry. Okay, coming to stage 2, it is light or REM sleep. So again, eyes won't be open. There won't be regular respiratory pattern since the baby will be in REM stage of sleep. There won't be any gross movements of the baby. And again, there won't be any vocalization or cry. What is stage 3? Stage 3, the baby is just about to being awake. So lightly awake or in the drowsy state, just woken up baby. So again, since the baby has just woken up, the respiratory pattern will be regular, correct? But there again won't be any gross movements or cry. When the baby is a bit more awake in alert state, that time again, baby cannot have regular respiratory patterns, correct? Then there will be gross movements of the baby, but there won't be vocalization or cry. Finally, coming to the last stage 5, eyes will be open, gross movements will be there, and baby will be vocalizing or crying, okay? Fine. That was to do with Prechel scale. Now, what is the other scale? Other scale is Bresselton scale, correct? This is also divided into 6 stages. One is the stage of deep sleep, stage of deep sleep. Next is active or light sleep, drowsy, awake and alert, alert but fuzzy and crying. Okay, fine. Next, we'll look at the cry of the baby. Next, we'll look at the cry of the baby. Over here, what all we'll see? We'll look at the volume, we'll look at the pitch, we'll look at the appropriateness of the cry, and we'll look at the quantity, okay? This is how we comment, okay? A high-pitched, incessant cry, unconsolable cry, indicates that the child is irritable, mainly cerebral irritability. But a weak cry usually indicates that the baby is having sepsis or some sort of neuromuscular disease, okay? So let's listen to one of the cry patterns. Thank you. Okay, fine. I'm not able to play this. Okay. That was just an audio book on high pitch cry. Okay. Now let's look into the behavior. Okay. What is the pattern of behavior in a normal newborn? Any normal newborn, if it is once the baby is born, the baby cries for around 20 to 30 minutes after birth. Okay. That is 20 to 30 minutes, the baby cries immediately after birth. Then the baby goes into sleep, 3 to 4 hours of sleep. Once the baby is exposed to the external environment, it will be irritable, correct? Since because it is not used to the environment. So initially it cries for around 20 to 30 minutes. Then once we give the baby's, the mother's milk, once the baby feeds, it will go into sleep for around 3 to 4 hours, okay? And then this sleep-wake cycle continues, 3 to 4 hours of sleep. Again, baby gets up, again 3 to 4 hours of sleep. And what is also important is that in this first 2 to 3 days, the circadian rhythm is not yet set in the baby, okay? So it will usually be remain awake at night and cry, correct? So the normal circadian rhythm only sets in after 3 to 4 days. So again, initially the parents might come to us complaining that the child is totally awake at the night crying, but during the daytime it sleeps off, okay? Again, the parents will become apprehensive, but it is totally normal in the initial 3 to 4 days, okay? Next, we look at habituation. Okay? Habituation is to repeated stimuli, something like labellar tap or repeated motor reflex or repeated shining of a torch. What happens on repeating shining of a torch? The baby will initially close its eye for initial 3 to 4 stimuli, correct? After that, it stops. After that, it gets used to it. If this doesn't take place, then some amount of neurological abnormality is there. Okay, it indicates that there is some amount of neurological abnormality. Okay. So there is nothing but labellar tap. So initial few, this thing, the baby responded, correct? For initial 3 to 4, this thing, tapping, baby responded. After that, the baby stopped responding to it, like we can see in this video. Okay, that was labellar tap. That is how we do labellar tap and check for habituation. Okay, next we see consolability. Okay, if the baby is, usually, normally the baby is either readily consolable or it is consolable with some amount of difficulty. Okay, again, inconsolability indicates there is some amount of irritability. Mostly it can be secondary to cerebral irritability, or it can be because of new onset sepsis setting in, correct? So you look at the consolability. Then we look at the cuddliness of the baby, willingness of the baby to be handled. Okay, so these are the things we look under higher mental function. Okay, higher mental function, first look at the consciousness, what state of consciousness the baby is in, preferably examining stage 3. Okay, then we'll go look at the cry, then we look at the behavior of the baby, we look at whether baby is getting habituated or not, we look at the consolability, and we look at the cuddliness. Okay, so these are the headings under which we'll have to be commenting in higher mental function. Next coming to the cranial nerve examination, we can only do a brief cranial nerve examination in the babies, as we cannot do a in detail examination like in older children or adults. We can only do a brief examination, correct? So this brief examination will include what all? Usually cranial nerve 1, it cannot be tested. Cranial nerve 2, what all we check? We look for response to light, whether the pupils are reactive or not. And in some slightly older baby, we look for fixation, whether the child is fixing into the light object that is shown. Okay, that's all you check in cranial nerve 2. 3, 4, and 6, what you look? You look for the range of movements of the eye. Okay, range of all the extraocular movements. Okay, and some amount of squint and nystagmus is normal. It is physiological, as we stated it in the starting of the class. Then you look for Doll's eye movement. What is Doll's eye movement? We'll come to it later. Okay, that is how you check for 3, 4, and 6. 2, just look for fixation and just look for the pupils, whether it is reactive or not. 3, 4, and 6, just look for range of movements of the eyeball, okay? And 5, you can check for corneal reflex and response to touch on face. Like 5, if you want to touch, you can just do a you can just look here for the response. Just you can just try to do rooting reflex, correct? On doing rooting reflex, the child will turn the face, correct? That indicates that cranial nerve 5 is intact, okay? Then coming to 7. 7, it is again easy. You make the baby cry. If the facial expression is good, there is no asymmetry in the face, it is well indicative that 7th nerve is intact, okay? Next, coming to 8th now. 8th now, it's simple to check. Just do startled reflex. That is nothing but you just stay some 30 centimeter away from the baby and give a nice loud clap. Okay, the baby will respond to it by crying, by flexing its body or by closing its eye. This will be the response of the baby to the stimuli. Correct? That is how you see 8th now. 9th and 10th now, if the suck and swallow reflex is good, it indicates that 9th, 10th and now is intact. Okay. Then 11th now, look for the sternocleidomastoid bulk after extending the neck and moving it laterally. Okay. 12th now, you can just examine it by looking at the tongue. Okay. So this is how we do a brief examination of the cranial nerve. Okay. Next, coming to the motor system. Under motor system, what are the headings we'll look for? One is the posture. Okay. So when does baby attain its normal posture of that universal flexion is around 32 to 40 weeks. This is when it develops. Okay. So what is the normal universal flexion posture? There will be some degree of abduction at the thighs. As we see over here, there is some degree of abduction at the thighs and flexion at the elbows, hip and ankle. Okay. There will be some degree of abduction followed by flexion. Okay. This is the normal universal flexion posture. Okay. Next, we look at what are the abnormal posture. What are the abnormal posture? One is frog-like posture. Okay. This is indicative that the baby is hypotonic. As you see in this picture. Okay. This is nothing but frog-like posture. The baby is hypotonic. Correct. So what position the baby will be if it is in frog-like posture? There'll be full abduction of legs. Okay. Even in normal posture, there'll be abduction. Even in full hypotonic baby with frog-like posture as well, there will be abduction. But what is the difference is, over here, the abduction will be sufficient enough to cause the lateral thigh to rest upon the supporting surface. Okay. Look over here. Look in this normal thing, the full lateral aspect of the thigh is not resting on the bed. But over here, all the lateral aspect of the thigh is resting on the bed. Correct? That is how we differentiate. Okay. And arms will be, some amount of flexion will be there at elbow with the dorsum of the hand against the supporting surface. Okay. This is the classical frog-like posture. You can see the image and you can differentiate between the universal flexed posture and the frog-like posture. Okay. Then in case of hypertonia, what will be the position? In case of hypertonia, there will be scissoring, there will be fisting, and there will be opisthotonous posturing. Again, we can see in these two images. What you can see the scissoring taking place in the legs. And there is some degree of opisthotonus in the baby, correct? There is opisthotonus and there will be scissoring, correct? So this is how a baby in hypertonic state looks like. And there will be fisting, correct? You can see over here, fisting. Next. So now we have commented on the posture, first thing in the motor system. Next, we look at the tone. So how do we assess tone? Muscle tone is assessed in the newborn or older infant as follows. First is the observation of posture, which we have already done. Then just feel for the muscles, okay? Whether it is flabby or whether it is hypertonic, you will get to know by feeling for the muscles. Then assessing the resistance to passive movement, okay? Assessing the resistance to passive movement. That is nothing but passive tone. There will be, again, we can check for two types of tone. One is active, other is passive, correct? One is active and other is passive. What is this passive tone? Passive tone is defined as resistance of limb to movements. Any movements you make, whatever resistance do you feel, that is the passive tone, okay? Then what is this active tone? The definition for active tone is, it is the tone that is observed when infant makes an active movement in reaction to certain situations. So you put the baby into certain situation, like you put the baby into vertical suspension, or you put the baby into ventral suspension, the reaction that the baby makes in response to that is nothing but testing the active tone. Okay. Then you assess range of movements. Then you just shake the limb and see. And indirect assessment will be by looking at the tendon jerk, by looking at the plantar response, and by looking at the Morse reflex. Okay. Fine. Good. Then traction response. How do we see for passive response? Just look for all the range of movements of all the limbs, and you look, see whether there is any resistance felt or not. Okay. That is how you see for passive tone. Next, we'll see active tone. How do we look for active tone? One is traction response. How do we see traction response? So this is how we see traction response. Once we hold the baby's palm, once we just strike the ulnar aspect of the baby's palm, the baby will hold onto your hand. After that, just try to lift the hand. Okay, and baby gives certain resistance when you try to lift the hand, as shown in this video. This is how we check the traction response. If there is certain amount of good resistance to this movement, okay, see, we are easily able to lift the hand because of certain amount of resistance that is provided by the baby. If it was hypotonic, then we would have, the child's fingers would have just slipped away. The child's fingers would have slipped away on trying to move the hand above. Okay, so this is the traction response. Hold the baby, elicit palmar reflex, and try to lift the palm. And you check for the resistance for the movement. Okay, that is demonstration of traction response. Okay, next, what do we do? Next, how do we see for active tone? Next is vertical suspension of the baby. Okay, so baby on vertical suspension of the baby, as shown in this picture. Okay, baby keeps the trunk extended with flexion of hip and knees. Okay, with flexion of hip and knees. Look, on keeping the baby in ventral suspension, there is good amount of flexion, correct? Flexion of hip and knees is present with extension of the trunk, okay? This is normal vertical suspension, okay? This is the normal response to vertical suspension. In case of hypotonic infant, what happens? Baby will just slip through the examiner's hand. In case of hypertonic reflex, what happens? There will be scissoring. The legs will cross itself. As shown in this figure, there will be scissoring on keeping the baby on vertical suspension. Okay. After vertical suspension, we'll check for ventral suspension. Okay. In this, what happens? Head rises intermittently and limbs flex against the gravity. Look over here. Head is raised and limbs are flexed against gravity, correct? This is how you elicit for ventral suspension, okay? In case of hypotonia, what happens? In case of hypotonia, baby is totally limp, okay? There'll be extended limbs and head will be dropping, okay? So what happens is you'll get this classical U shape. You'll get this U shape because the baby is limp. Trunk won't be extended. So trunk falls, then head won't lift itself. So again, head also falls and legs won't flex, correct? So leg also falls. And in case of hypertonia, what happens? You will get inverted U, correct? Because of the opisthotonous posturing, you will get this inverted U appearance. Okay, fine, good. Next, you do pull to sit, okay? And while eliciting this pull to sit, look for the relation between head and trunk. And one important thing is when you're eliciting all these things, head should be in the midline. Okay. Make sure that head is in the midline or else we'll get an asymmetric response. Okay. So what is normal pull to sit? There'll be an initial lag and then head would be pulled up in the plane of the body. Okay. In the plane of the body, as compared to a hypotonic infant, wherein there'll be a significant head lag. Head will be lagging throughout the time. But when it is normal, initially when you pull the baby to sit, there will be an initial lag and followed by head would be in the plane of the body. Okay. Now let's just see how to elicit this pull to response. Okay. See, this is how we elicit pull to response. Keep the head in the midline. keep the head in the midline, then pull the baby, pull the baby. Initial there is head lag and followed by head will be in the plane of the body, correct? Once again, we'll play the video. Keep the head in the midline. It is not just for this, for all the things you elicit, head should be in the midline. Pull the baby, initial head lag, followed by head will be in the plane of the body. Okay, good, fine. If there is total head lag, that means the baby is hypotonic, okay? Then we look for deep tendon reflexes, okay? So we saw tone, we check for both passive tone, we check for active tone, okay? Then coming to the reflex. Now what happens is in the newborns, we can elicit all the reflexes, but it might not be well developed. Okay, it might not be well developed. It takes some amount of time for all the reflexes to develop in the newborn. So the only reflex that is consistently present is patellar tendon reflex. So only the knee jerk reflex is consistently present. And how do we elicit it? It is just simple. Just go with your finger, just tap on the knee, just tap on the patellar tendon and just look for the reflex. Okay, it is simple. Okay. Then we elicit, after eliciting deep tendon reflexes, we'll elicit primitive neonatal reflexes. Okay. So always examine this in awake and alert state, preferably stage three again. Okay. So the first question when it comes to primitive neonatal reflexes is, when is the onset? Okay. When it becomes fully developed and when does it disappear? Okay. So this will be the first question that will be asked. So let's see. So when does Palmer grasp come? Palmer grasp's onset is at 28 week, okay? Fully developed at 32 week, and it disappears by 2 to 3 months of postnatal age. Okay, second one is rooting reflex. Rooting reflex sets in at 32 weeks period of gestation. Then it is fully developed at 36 weeks period of gestation. And when does it disappear? It is less prominent after 1 month of life. Next, Moros reflex. Moros reflex, again, onset is 28 to 32 weeks. It gets fully developed by 37 weeks and duration is 5 to 6 months of postnatal age. Okay. Next, coming to tonic neck reflex, asymmetric tonic neck reflex, onset is 35 weeks. Okay. Fully developed by 1 month. Okay. And it exists up to 6 to 7 months of postnatal period. Okay. Next is parachute reflex. Parachute reflex, the onset is much later. Okay. 7 to 8 months of your postnatal life, it sets in. Okay, it gets developed by around 12 months and it remains throughout life. So we won't be able to elicit this at the starting. Okay, when we do our newborn examination, we will not be able to elicit this parachute reflex. And if in case they ask how to elicit this, just make a movement so that hold the baby in ventral suspension. Okay, and try to make the baby fall. Okay, at that time, the heads and the legs will extend. Okay, as to protect itself. Okay, that is how you elicit parachute reflex. Okay, then sucking or swallowing reflex. Okay, this comes at 32 weeks. What is the significance of this sucking, rooting and swallowing reflex? Since the onset is only at 32 weeks and it becomes developed by 36 weeks or 34 weeks, before this, we will not be able to feed the child. We will not be able to breastfeed the child. Okay, so breastfeeding should be tried only after 34 weeks. Until then, we can try OGT feeds or PALDA, and only after 32 weeks, we can start trying breastfeed, correct? Okay. Breastfeeding or PALDA feeding, okay? After 32 weeks. Until then, we'll have to try NGT feeds or OGT feeds, okay? Fine. Next is placing or stepping reflex, okay? It sets in at 35 weeks, gets fully developed by 37 weeks, and it will stay up to 6 months. Next is crossed extension reflex, okay? Onset is 34 weeks, fully developed by 38 weeks, and duration is 4 to 5 months. Okay, this table is really important and you guys have to remember this because this will invariably be asked in the exam. Okay, so this is a very important table. Fine. Good. Next, we'll see how do we elicit each of these reflexes. Okay. We'll see how do we elicit each of these reflexes. First one is sucking reflex. Okay. So this is quite easy. Wash your hands, preferably wear gloves, and place the finger in the neonate's mouth. Or just observe how the baby sucks into the mother's breast. Okay, sucks into the mother's breast. Okay, so what will be the normal response? It sucks onto the finger or nipple forcefully, okay, and rhythmically. And once 34 weeks is over, the sucking and swallowing will be coordinated. Okay, sucking and swallowing will be coordinated. Now, just let's see how we elicit it as explained now. So, wash your hands, wear your gloves, and see the baby is, and just stimulate the heart palate. Okay, just stimulate the heart palate. On stimulating the heart palate, the baby will suck vigorously. Correct. On stimulating the heart palate, the baby will suck vigorously and rhythmically. See, the baby is sucking onto the finger on stimulating the heart palate. Fine. What is the next reflex? Next is the rooting reflex. How do we elicit rooting reflex? Rooting reflex is easy. Just go to the corner of the baby's mouth. Just go to the corner of the baby's mouth and stroke. Okay. Touch a finger to the neonate's cheek on the corner of the mouth and just make stroking movements. Okay. On doing this, what happens? Baby turns the head towards the stimulus. Okay. Baby turns the head towards the stimulus. Okay. This is just natural. On once the baby's mother's areola or nipple touches the baby's corner of the mouth, the baby will turn its head to suck onto the breast. Correct. So this is the natural reflex of the baby. Okay. Fine. Next is pupillary reflex. Just shine a torch from the corner, the pupils will constrict. Okay, next is doll's eye. Okay, next is doll's eye. How do we do this? Keep the neonate in supine position and slowly turn the neonate's head to either side. Okay, to either side, turn the neonate's head. We'll see how to do it. And what will be the normal response? What will be the normal response? The eyes remain stationary and appear to move in the opposite direction. Okay, fine. It's better we see how to elicit this. So if you are asked to demonstrate how do you do, then this is how you do it. Okay. So tilt the baby towards this side and the opposite side. Okay. On tilting the baby, we see that there will be apparent movement of the eye towards the opposite side. Correct. See, baby's eye is not actually moving, but that means there will be apparent movement. Okay. So this indicates that the brainstem of the baby is intact. Okay, brainstem of the baby is intact. Doll's eye is one of the tests done to see whether brainstem is intact or not. Okay, fine. Doll's eye is done. Next is Moro's. Okay, how do we do Moro's? Suddenly but gently drop the neonate's head backward. Okay, suddenly but gently do it and drop the neonate's head backward. Okay, then again there are two phases. Correct. There are two phases in Moro's. In first phase, what happens? In first phase, there will be extension and abduction of all the extremities bilaterally and symmetrically forms the C shape. Okay. And then there will be opening up of all the fingers. Correct. There will be extension and abduction of all the extremities bilaterally and symmetrically and opening up of all the fingers. And the whole thing will be in C shape. The whole thing will make a C shape. Okay. And this is followed by phase two. This is followed by phase two. What happens in phase two? There'll be adduction and it flexes. Baby flexes all the extremities. There'll be first adduction and flexion of all the extremities. And this is followed by a cry. This is followed by a cry. Okay. So this is Moro's reflex. Phase one and phase two of Moro's reflex. Let's see how to elicit it again. So gently drop the neonate's head. See, once we drop the neonate's head, there will be abduction and opening up of all the fingers, followed by adduction, closing of all the fingers and cry. Okay. So you can see all the movements, phase one and phase two, phase one and phase two. This is how we do Moro's reflex. Okay. Fine, good. Now, next, what is startle reflex? What is startle reflex? On making a loud on making a loud noise near the neonate. And how do we make this noise? Just stay around 30 centimeter away from the neonate and give a nice loud clap. Okay, stay some centimeter, stays around 15 to 30 centimeter away from the neonate and give a good loud clap. What happens that time? The baby cries and abducts all the extremities and followed by flexion of all the extremities. Okay, initially baby cries and abducts, followed by flexion of the extremities. This is startle reflex. This also indicates that eighth nerve is normal. Eighth nerve is normal in the child. Hearing is normal. Okay, fine. Next is Palmar grasp reflex. Next is Palmar grasp reflex. This is easy to elicit. Okay, just the stroke your little finger, stroke your little finger on the ulnar aspect onto the child's palm. Okay, the child will hold your palm firmly. Okay, that is Palmar grasp and plantar grasp. Okay, fine. Then what is stepping reflex? What is stepping reflex? Over here, we hold the neonate in upright position. Okay, and touch one foot lightly onto a flat surface. And then the baby will make walking motions with both the feet. Okay, we'll see. We'll just see how to elicit it. See, keep the baby onto a flat surface. There's some problem with the net. We'll just try again. So on keeping the baby's foot onto a flat surface, see, the baby is making walking movements, correct? Initially it took the left foot and then followed by right foot. On just placing the baby's foot into the flat surface, see, left foot and right foot, correct? So this is how the baby makes walking movements, okay? Fine, good. Then followed by crossed extension. How do we, this is quite difficult to elicit. Again, for all these reflexes, head should be in the midline, okay? Then position the neonate supine with head in the midline, okay? And extend one leg, okay? And extend one of the leg, okay? And stimulate the sole, okay? As though you're tickling to the onto the baby's foot, stimulate the sole. What happens? The baby will flex the opposite limb. So on keeping the head midline, one of the limb we extend and stimulate the sole. The opposite limb, the baby will flex. This is cross extension. Okay. Then Babinski. Babinski, we all know how to elicit. Stroke onto the one side of the neonate's foot. On stroking onto the neonate's foot onto the one side, okay, there will be hyperextension. And there will be hyperextension of the toes. Okay. There will be hyper. Usually, there will be upgoing Babinski in newborns. Okay. And that is considered normal. Usually, there will be upgoing Babinski in the newborns. So we'll just see how to elicit. Just stroke. See, there will be hyperextension of all the toes, correct? We'll play again, stroke the baby's foot, there'll be hyperextension. Fine. Now you've seen how to elicit all the reflexes, okay? And there was one image on asymmetric tonic neck reflex. This we forgot. If we tilt the baby's neck to one side, okay, if we tilt the baby's neck to one side, on the ipsilateral side, there will be extension, okay, and on the opposite side, there will be flexion. Ipsilateral side, there is extension, and on the opposite side, there will be flexion. This is ATNR, asymmetric tonic neck reflex, okay. So we've seen how to elicit all the reflexes, correct? Fine. Next. And then they will ask, when do we find asymmetric motors? This will be one of the Viva question. complete and incomplete moros, the last complete moro is after it is fully developed, 37 weeks period of gestation. Then when do we have asymmetric or incomplete moros? One, when there is some trauma, correct? When there is clavicle fracture or there is brachial plexus injury, this will be the cause. This will be the cause for asymmetric moros, okay? That will be one other viva question. Then let's see what about ankle clonus, okay? Ankle clonus. This is again a normal finding in newborn infant, okay? And it disappears rapidly with age, and beyond 3 months, if it is present, then only it is abnormal. Because in pediatric or adolescent or adult age group, existence of ankle clonus itself is normal. But in case of newborn, at day one of life, it might be present, but as it progresses, as the age increases, it disappears, and by beyond 3 months, it is not supposed to exist. Okay, sensory examination is simple. Okay, gross response to touch and pain. We just see gross response to touch and pain. Okay, premature infants of even 28 weeks, okay, as early as 28 weeks, can discriminate between touch and pain. So sensory system is well developed in newborns. Okay, how do we pain to a normal touch? The baby responds by being alert and slight motor activity. And to pain, the baby will withdraw its limbs and cry. Okay, so this was the neurological examination of newborns. We do it under all these settings. Okay, first we see the higher mental function. Okay, under higher mental function, consciousness. Okay, cry, behavior, habituation, consolability, and cuddliness. Next is the cranial nerve examination. Next is the motor system under the posture. Okay, tone. Then deep tendon reflex and primitive neonatal reflex, followed by a simple sensory examination. How the baby responds to touch and pain. Okay, fine. Next is again one more very important thing, gestational age assessment. Next important thing is gestational age assessment, and that will be our last topic. Okay, so how do we assess the gestational age? One is based on our last menstrual period. Okay, last date of menstrual period. Okay. Followed by that Negley's rule, 9 months and 7 days. We add 9 months plus 7 days. Okay. Negley's rule and modified Negley's rule, and we can apply and find out when, what is the gestational age of the baby. Next is the dating scan that we do in the first trimester. That is also appropriate to find out the gestational age of the baby. Okay. After dating, after the first trimester, it doesn't be that valid. But once done in the first trimester, plus or minus 7 days, we can take. Plus or minus 7 days can be taken. Correct? So, done. We are done with this part. Then second one is the grading system which we use. This is based on certain physical and neurological characteristics of the baby. Okay? So, based on certain physical and neurological characteristics, there were two scoring system. Okay? Initially came the Dubovitz scoring. Okay? Dubovitz scoring. But this was too cumbersome to do because it contained 22 items, of which 10 were neurological and 12 physical characteristics. These were too cumbersome to elicit. That's why came the Ballard system, Ballard scoring. Okay, and the present one being the modified one being the new Ballard scoring. And under new Ballard scoring, there is 6 neurological and 6 physical. So that will sum up to 12 items. Okay, and with this, we can elicit from 20 weeks period of gestation to 44 weeks period of gestation with a score of minus 10 to plus 50. Okay, fine. So what are the things we see under neuromuscular? One, first is neuromuscular, second is physical. Okay, first is neuromuscular, second is physical. This is physical characteristics. Okay, this is the physical characteristics. First, let's see about the neuromuscular. Under neuromuscular, first is posture. First is the posture. Okay, and it differs from a very extreme preterm baby to a preterm baby, to a extreme preterm, to a moderate preterm, to a term and postterm baby. It will differ. Okay, the tone of the baby is going to be developed, and the physical characteristics of the baby is going to change when compared to a preterm baby, to term baby, to postterm baby. And that is how we get the scoring. Okay, first one is posture. And posture, we have already seen the difference. We have already seen the difference between a preterm and term baby. Correct? In term baby, it will be in a good universally flexed position. Correct? But in preterm baby, it is not so. Because the flexion I forgot to tell this, I think so, correct? So the flexion, no, it usually develops in the distal. Normally all the development goes from head to toe, correct? Craniocaudal. But the flexion in newborns, it is from caudal to rostral, caudal to, from distal to proximal, okay? From, so the initial flexor tone comes in the legs followed by the limbs, okay? That is what this says, okay? So initially the flexion won't be that good, okay? Followed by, once the term comes, the, once the baby becomes term, the flexion will become good, okay? Universal flex position. That is what is seen over here, preterm versus term. And that is what is given in the scoring also, from 0 to plus 5, okay? See, over here, there is no good flexure tone, but over here, flexure tone is well developed, okay? That was to do with the flexion. Next is the square window. Next is the square window, okay? So this is the square window. We'll see first how to elicit square window, okay? How do we elicit this square window? See, so first we extend all the fingers of the baby. First we extend all the fingers of the baby, okay? And then flex it near the wrist. Flex it near the wrist, okay? And gently flex it. Don't try to flex too much and try to assess the flexor tone of the wrist. Extend all the fingers, okay? Then try to gently flex the elbow and see the, look for the flexor tone and look for how much amount we'll be able to flex the wrist, okay? How much amount we'll be able to flex the wrist. So and based on that we grade, okay? Again, since the flexor tone is well developed in term, we'll be able to fully flex. But over here, we won't be able to fully flex when it compared to preterms. So that is what is being seen. Here only we are able to flex this much, whereas over here we are able to flex this much, correct? So this is the difference between a preterm and term. Again, next. Next, what is the grading? What is the neuromuscular grading used? Next one is arm recoil. Arm recoil, okay? Next, we'll see how do we elicit this arm recoil. So there are two things. One is for preterm and one is for term. So how do we elicit arm reflexes? Just extend the baby's hand, okay? Extend the baby's hand and just leave it, okay? Extend the baby's hand and leave it. Since the flexor tone is not well developed in newborn, the baby will not flex its hand, okay? Only this much response will be there. As compared to a term baby, wherein the flexor tone is well developed, okay? See, now we'll see the difference between a preterm and term. See, there is such good flexion response. There is a very good flexor response. Okay. So that is how we elicit arm reflex. Okay. After arm recoil comes the popliteal angle. Okay. After arm recoil comes the popliteal angle. So we have finished with 1, 2, 3, and this is the fourth one. Okay. Popliteal angle. Now, how do we look for popliteal angle? See. You take the baby's leg, okay? Keep one of the fingers near the ankle, sorry, near the knee, okay? And just try to extend the knee, okay? So take the baby's leg, take the baby's leg, fix it near the ankle with the help of your finger and just try to extend, okay? Try to extend it. Take the baby's leg, fix the near the ankle, okay? And just try to extend it slightly. and look for the resistance and look for the resistance. Okay, wherever you get the resistance, stop over there. Okay, wherever you get the resistance, stop. Okay, and this is the grading as the maturity progresses. See, the same thing is shown in the image also. Over here, we are able to extend this much in a preterm neonate, okay, as compared to a term. We are only able to extend this much because of good flexor tone. We are only able to extend this much as compared to this much in case of a preterm neonate. Okay, fine. So this was the example for popliteal angle. Next is the scarf sign. Next, you will be asked to elicit how do you examine for scarf sign. Okay, let's see. So keep the head in the midline, okay? Keep the head in the midline, fix the shoulder, okay? And try to cross. Try to cross and get the... Keep the head in the midline, support the shoulder, hold the hands and get the hands to the opposite shoulder, to the tip of the opposite shoulder and see where does the elbow come and see for where does the elbow come. Okay, if the elbow crosses the midline or not, or how much close to the midline we are able to get the elbow. Okay, that is what you see. And if it totally crosses, then it is more preterm as compared to term. We will be able to see only this much as we saw in the video, but over here we will be able to cross it fully. Okay, that is what you see in this image also. This is a preterm baby wherein the elbow is crossing the midline as compared to a term baby wherein the elbow is right over here. Okay, fine. This is how you elicit scarf sign. Now what is it after scarf sign? Final grading for neuromuscular is heel to ear. Heel to ear. How do we elicit heel to ear? Now, in case of heel to ear, okay, flex, fix the knee, okay, fix the knee at the, fix the hip near the joint, fix the hip near the joint, okay, and then you try to extend the leg. Instead of, when it came to popliteal angle, we had flexed it, fix the knee, over here, we'll fix the hip and then try to extend, okay, and we'll see how much we'll be able to extend, okay. In case of a preterm neonate, will be able to extend it fully as compared to term neonate. Okay. In case of a preterm neonate, will be able to extend it fully as compared to term neonate, as we saw in the video just now. Okay. See, over here we are able to extend fully as compared to a term neonate. Okay, fine. So this was about neuromuscular grading, 6 neuromuscular grading. Okay. Next, we'll see. Look at the physical characteristics. Physical characteristics, first one is the skin. Okay, first one is the skin. When it comes to preterm, the skin will be smooth, pink, with nice visible veins. When it comes to preterm, as we see over in this image, nice, smooth, pink skin with some amount of lanugo, correct? Okay, we are not able to see visible veins because the child is a bit more developed. As compared to term and post-term baby, in case of post-term baby, what happens? This is a picture of postterm baby. Okay, there is wrinkling as you find over here. There is wrinkling, correct? There is wrinkling and peeling of the skin is present. Peeling of the skin is present. This is the characteristic of the skin. This is how we differentiate a preterm term from a postterm. Okay, next comes for the presence of lanugo. There will be abundant lanugo when it comes to a preterm baby as compared to a term baby, wherein it will be some mostly bald areas. Okay. Look over here, there is abundant amount of lanugo in this preterm baby. After that, look at the plantar surface. After that, look at the plantar surface, correct? When it comes to preterm baby, there will be faint red marks. If a child is a bit more developed, you will find only the anterior transverse crease, correct? Anterior transverse crease only as compared to a good, nice developed term, baby, where there will be crease all over the sole, all over the sole. See, faint red marks in this preterm baby as compared to this preterm baby, which is a bit more developed, nice trans, anterior transverse crease only is developed, as compared to this baby, wherein there is creases all over the sole. Okay, this is how you differentiate preterm from term. Then look at the breast, development of the breast. In case of extreme preterm, it will be barely perceptible. When it comes to a bit more developed, flat areola will be there, but no bud. Okay, some small amount of areola with 1 to 2 mm bud, but when it comes to a nice developed baby, there'll be a full areola with 5 to 10 mm bud. Okay, yes, see over here, it is almost imperceptible. It is almost imperceptible. Okay, over here, there is small amount of areola with some stippled areola with 1 to 2 mm bud. Over here, it is nice, well developed areola with 5 to 10 mm nipple. Correct, 5 to 10 mm nipple. Next characteristic is you look at the ears or eyes. Okay, ears and eyes. Fifth one is ears and eyes. What do we do over here? If the ear is well formed, okay, with thick cartilage, it is term as compared to preterm. As compared to preterm, wherein it will be the ears won't be well formed, and on pressing the ear, the recoil will be very slow. One is the ears won't be well formed, and if we press the ear, okay, the recoil is very slow. And next final one is the genitals, male and female. Okay, when it comes to male, the preterm baby, the testicles will not be descended, or it will be on the way to be descended, and the scrotum will not have enough Ruginic. Okay, as compared to a term baby, the testicles will be descended with nice good amount of Ruginic. Okay, nice good amount of Ruginic. This is almost moderate preterm baby, wherein there will be slight Ruginic and testicles are still descending. Okay, and then when it comes to females, when it's a preterm baby, labia, and it's a term baby, the labia majora will be covering. As you see over here, the labia majora will be covering the labia minora and clitoris, as compared to a preterm baby, wherein the labia majora is still not fully developed and clitoris becomes prominent. Okay, so these are the features to differentiate a preterm baby from term baby. Okay, this question will invariably ask, and these are the features which we use, and the scoring system uses Ballard scoring. And now coming to one last question being, how do you differentiate a postterm baby? What are the features of a postterm baby? Correct. So what are the features of the postterm baby? We have already seen one. That was the skin. Correct. So there will be a dry, loose skin. Correct. Dry, loose skin will be there. There will be wrinkling. Then there will be peeling of skin. In case of a postterm baby. Then what will be there? Then the nails will be overgrown. Overgrown nails will be there. Okay. Then the palmar creases will be well developed. There will be creases all over the soles. Correct. These are few points of postterm baby. Okay. So I think with this, we can conclude the session. And hope you guys are confident with the examination of newborn, because almost whatever is needed, we have seen how to demonstrate all the things. Video demonstration you guys have seen. So if in case you guys have any doubts, you guys can always message me or mail me. Okay. And if you guys want these videos, any separate videos also, we'll try to put it up on YouTube. And if you guys have doubt as to elicit any response, you can always go back and go through the video, or I'll also try to put separate 5 to 10 seconds snap of each of the videos. Okay, when time provides. So guess we can end the session. So full examination of newborn we are done with. Okay, fine. Thank you. Hope the session.